need a kiss now.
I need a kiss now. Kiss, Mom.
Need a kiss.
Yeah. Oh. Kiss. Oh, I like that.
Don't be creepy.
Can you kiss it again?
No.
Mom.
Yeah, well, that's, oh, out of tie. That's out of tie.
Do it again.
Hey, Nick, time. That's out of tie now. Come on, man. Hey,
come on. I missed it. Hey,
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, good morning. We'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you and to thank each and every one of you for coming to support the family and extend your thoughts and prayers and sympathies to this dear family and the loss of Brother Elmer. I want to begin by reading a passage of Scripture here today. I'm reading from the 27th Psalm, where the Bible says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. From the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. And now shall mine head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When thou sayest, Seek ye my face, my heart said unto thee, Thy face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up." I've been asked to read a couple of things that have been written by family members as just tributes to Brother Elmer and the life that he lived. I'm going to begin by reading a tribute written by his granddaughter, Elena, and she also includes some sentiments from Brother Elmer's daughter, Debbie, as well. She writes, My grandpa, Pawpaw, as we called him, was a man of integrity. He was a godly leader and role model to his family, even though he didn't become a believer until his late 20s. From that day on, he was a full follower of Christ. He completely immersed himself and his family into his home church of Midbrook Baptist Church, where he even became part of their leadership. He loved going out with fellow church members to witness to the lost about his love of the Lord and ultimately their salvation. He also had a love for the bus ministry in his church. He performed many acts of service, one of which was to help build an addition to the church's building. God later led him and Mama to Cleveland Baptist Church, where he remained a member for the rest of his life. He sure loved his Pastor Thompson and church family there. He loved singing out those good old hymns, praising and worshiping his Lord. Another wonderful example of his love for God was memories my mom has of him kneeling at his bedside, praying to his Lord. His love for God has trickled down to his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. I am forever grateful for his love and choice to follow the Lord and for his beautiful testimony. Papa was a man of few words, but what he had to say was worth listening to. You would either receive a nugget of great wisdom or get teased. And boy, was he a teaser. He loved telling the story of when he worked at Chevy. He would very casually walk by the break room with a handful of ball bearings, bolts, and nuts. Then he would toss the noise-making parts to the metal roof. Why? He'd say, to shake them up in there. I remember him always teasing us grandkids. He was going to take a bite out of our food at any chance he got. I remember him using just about any situation to tease my mama, saying things like, "You Italians," or "That's the Italian in you." Papa had a love for others, and especially his wife. There wasn't anything he wouldn't do for her. They were an inspiration to their family of what a godly, loving marriage should look like. A sweet memory I have of them is any time I'd spend the night at their house, in the morning, her Johnny, as she affectionately called him, would make a coffee run and bring it back to her for them to share together. Any errand she had or things she needed to be fixed, he gladly did it. He was a dedicated father, leader, protector, and provider. He loved his infant sons, Elmer Ray and Ronald Kay, who sadly died in infancy. Throughout the years, he would make his way back to his hometown in West Virginia to visit and maintain their gravesite. He loved his daughters, Debbie and Sherry, tremendously. Whatever, whenever, and wherever they needed him, he was there. He loved his parents, Glenn and Edna May, his siblings, Daryl, Roy, and late sisters, Jenny, and his twin sister, Elaine Fay. I loved seeing and hearing how excited he was when he would hear from or see any of his siblings. His love of his grand and great-grandbabies was a sight to behold. His whole demeanor would change. There would be a pep to his step, and he would change the pitch of his voice to be higher and sweeter while talking to us. A lot of times, as soon as we'd step in his house, he'd make a beeline to the cupboard to get one of his silver ice cream bowls down so we could eat ice cream together. I miss hearing his whistles he'd do to us to get our attention, his little grin and wink he gave us while he was teasing others. Anytime he heard I was coming to his house, he'd either slip cash in my pocket for gas money or leave me a note with some. I still have some of those notes. He helped me with my down payment of my first car. He also gave me a Chevy employee discount when purchasing it. Another sweet memory I have of him while growing up is some mornings waking up to him mowing our lawn unannounced. My mom has memories of him just stopping by unannounced with gifts of food. When it was chicken from V's, he'd say, "The chicken man is here." Or when he'd bring donuts over, he'd say, "The donut man is here." Other things he loved were hats. I think we all ran with that love because just about any gift-giving day, he'd receive a hat, whether it was a hat of the Army, West Virginia, or his beloved Cleveland Indians. He was almost guaranteed to be getting a hat. Pawpaw was a giver. Anytime you left his house, you left with a gift. Whether it was a piece of fruit, a can of pop, or any random thing you could find, you had something to take with you. He took so much pride in his country that he, unbeknownst to his parents, enlisted in the Army when he was only 16 years old. Once the Army figured out his true age, they booted him out. So Pawpaw went back home and got written permission from his father and officially joined the Army. He served in the Korean War as a sergeant. He loved his fellow soldiers, some of whom he lost in the war who were dear friends. He would often tell my mom of his one friend that died right next to him. Those unseen scars to his heart followed him all of his days. He wore his wounds with such dignity and grace. It was sweet to hear his happier stories of seeing fellow church members and his own brother Daryl overseas during the war. Pawpaw was a doer. Growing up, I always remember him being busy, busy, busy. He always had things to be, had places to be, and jobs to be done. Painting, fixing things, yard work, he was always doing something. He was a very active man. Even up to his last days of working at GM, you would see him riding his bike to and from work. 54 years he worked at the Parma plant. He took so much pride in those days. He was the inspector of the plant, and he had a tricycle there where he would cruise around to the different parts of the plant. It was sweet that when he would share stories of himself and his work buddies, you'd see the joy in his eyes. In 2007, he had a brain aneurysm that ruptured. Being a no-fuss man, he didn't want Mama to call 911 and have those lights flashing outside of his house, even though he literally had to crawl across the floor and down the stairs to get to her for help. There was a time after his surgery we said our goodbyes. It wasn't looking good at all. God pulled him through and gave him many more years. From day one of his life, especially being a twin baby boy in the 1930s, he had a fight for life. Even though after his surgery he lost use of his right side and had a very hard time communicating with others, I don't remember him ever once complaining. The only times I remember he'd even ever begin to cry was when he'd talk about lost loved ones, and especially Mama after she passed away, 4 short years after his stroke. He missed and loved her so, so much. Anytime we came to his house to visit, he would be talking about her and showing us her pictures that he had of her on display. Along with her pictures, he loved showing us his many other pictures of family members and loved ones, telling us many of his sweet memories the best he could. A few other items he loved to show off was his Chevy bow tie plaque with 54 gold coins that were set in it, representing each year of his employment. He also loved showing his lovely house plants he so tenderly cared for and about. His keepsake box filled with little pins from the Red Cross representing the many times he donated his blood. Also his American flag, Korean War, Man of Faith pins. I especially loved his picture of the love of his life he had in the center of the box. He leaves behind a family that love and miss him tremendously. The void he leaves in our hearts is huge, but we do have peace and joy knowing we will be reunited with him in heaven. What a beautiful thought I have of him right now, being reunited with Mama, his sons, his sisters, his parents, my dad, and his great-grandchildren who were lost in miscarriages. But I think the most beautiful thoughts are of his meeting his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, face to face. Thinking of him being able to walk the streets of gold and sing praises to his God. God is so good. I pray God's glory and love be shown through my Pawpaw's testimony and life to everyone who generously used their time and came today to show their love of Pawpaw and his family. Thank you. Can we pray together? Fathers, we begin this service, Lord, a service that certainly is designed to remember a life well lived. Lord, we also never want to lose sight of the fact that ultimately this is a service, as any service here in this church would be, that is designed to lift up the name of Jesus Christ. The reason that Elmer was able to live the life that his granddaughter described for us here in this portrait. And Lord, the things that we'll talk about here today is because of the difference that you made in his life. And so, Lord, we understand that Elmer is not really the center of this service today, Lord, and he would not want to be the center of the service today. But rather, his Savior, Jesus Christ, is the center of the service. So, Lord, we ask that you would be honored and glorified with what is said and done here today. Lord, may you use this time to encourage us all, Lord, to perhaps give hope to some that are here today without hope. And certainly, Lord, would you use this time today to inspire us to live lives even, Lord, greater than perhaps what we've tried to do in the past. Lord, fill us and use us today, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. The family has requested Mrs. Renee Hosey to come and to sing a familiar song, The Old Rugged Cross. She's coming to sing that now. Mrs. Hosey, that was a blessing. You heard a few moments ago from Elmer's granddaughter, and when I sat down with Sherry last week, of course, many of you know, we talked about this in what Elena had written, that in 2007, Brother Johnson had the aneurysm, and there was obviously some moments there in which they thought perhaps the Lord was going to take him much sooner than he did. And so there was some time in which there was some thought given to a funeral service, and then there was a period of years in which God allowed him to still be here. And so the family took opportunity, working with him, to put together sort of a snapshot of his life. And these are things that I'm given to understand Elmer wanted you to hear at his funeral service. And so I'm going to just read what the family has put together, working with him, and it just give you a little bit of a better understanding of the life that he lived. This is entitled, The Journey Begins. On Tuesday, October 4th, in a small two-bedroom green house with a tin roof, placed up on a hill in Prudence, West Virginia, picturesque mountain range and rolling hills piled one upon the other, Edna Mae Johnson gave birth to twins Elmer Ray and Elaine Fay. The year was 1932, the Great Depression, when a loaf of bread cost 7 cents, a can of pork and beans 5 cents, and 1 pound of hamburger 10 cents. The Johnson family grew up in Prudence, then moved to Dalton's home in Red Star to help with Edna Mae's parents, then moved to Harvey, then Glen Jean, then to Red Star. Elmer's siblings were brother Glenn Darrell Johnson, sister Irma Jean Jenny Evans, who is deceased, twin sister Elaine Faye Prophet, who is deceased, and younger brother Roy. They grew up with little means but got by. Elmer had a paper route, also as a mail clerk at Oak Hill Post Office, which allowed him to make some money to help with needs of the family. Just like his mom, he was very giving and cared for those in need. Mother Edna Mae, Christian woman, made sure the family attended Red Star Baptist Church. Elmer's dad, Glenn, worked as a coal miner. That was the only job at the time the coal camps formed then. In 1948, Elmer quit school and enlisted in the United States Army. Forging his papers, he got in. When they found out he was only 16, they sent him back home to West Virginia. When he turned 18, he enlisted again. Elmer had great passion to serve his country and wanted to fight for it. Jenny, his older sister, gave him a pocket-sized Bible to carry with him, saying, "One day, Elmer, you might need his word." He placed it in his pocket, boarded the train at the station in Thurmond, and left for Seoul, Korea. Jenny prayed for him constantly. "Heavenly Father, Lord, please keep your protection around my dear brother Elmer while he's in combat. Bring him home safely, Lord. Please show Elmer he needs you and open his heart, I pray, and save his soul and bring him home to his family." She wrote letters one after another to Elmer in Korea, letting him know she was praying for him every day and to confess his sins, believe that Jesus died on the cross for his sins, and believe in him and be saved. Letter after letter, the same message. She encouraged him to read the pocket Bible she gave him every day, told him Jesus will speak through the pages of his word, even in Korea. Elmer would write to Jenny and explain the Korean War was war. The weather was extreme, both low and high temperatures, and winds all the while they had to conduct very rapid advances. They were American soldiers, disciplined physically and mentally trained. They were teammates, they were family in their unit. Elmer was 1st Cavalry Lieutenant Company 3rd Battalion. They all needed to get the job done for our country. The mission was always first. They stood ready to engage and destroy the enemies of the United States of America. American soldiers, yes, and proud too. I serve the people of the United States and live the Army's values. I will always place the mission first. I will never accept defeat. I will never quit. This we'll defend. One afternoon, their commander gave them orders. Sit and wait and take out anything that comes over the ridge. They waited and waited. Then they heard something. It was a convoy coming over the ridge. They paused, and Elmer gave the orders to hold their fire. It was U.S. GIs. The incoming GIs had read their map wrong and had no idea they were in the wrong location. One of the GIs was from home, Wally Mosier. Elmer and Wally laughed for years and years when telling that story. One night that Elmer would never forget was when they had dug in for the night. Everything was quiet. His buddy had fallen asleep right next to him. The North Koreans started firing heavily. The war was right there coming at them. They were all firing. A hand grenade was thrown directly into their foxhole. His buddy Bob was killed, but it only did damage to Elmer's left ear. He held on to the pocket Bible Jenny had given him. He knew God was real and was there for him. Elmer knew only a miracle would get him out of there. He prayed out loud, "Lord, if you get me out of here, I will serve you and live for you." He rose up out of the foxhole because a soldier never quits. Elmer stood ready to engage. He could feel and hear the shrapnel hitting everywhere around him. He then returned fire, emptying his gun. Two enemy soldiers were right in front of him, but he was able to take them out. It was him or them. He did not realize at the time that one of them was an enemy general. The next day, Elmer got notice that General Douglas MacArthur was there. MacArthur asked who the soldier that protected the troops, and then the general put in an order for Elmer to become a sergeant, advanced up the ranks. MacArthur told Elmer, "Keep advancing, Sergeant. great job for defending the United States of America. It was a true honor for Elmer to meet General MacArthur. Elmer got his orders. He was going home to Camp Roberts in California to train our troops. Elmer and Helen were married in 1952 in Oak Hill, West Virginia. They moved to Cleveland to find work. First home, 4118 Bridge Avenue, lived there for a few years, then bought 2088 West 95th, then moved to 5735 Michael Drive, Brook Park. General Motors in Parma was hiring. Elmer was hired on May 21, 1953. He worked his way up to inspector and retired from GM on Thursday, August 31, 2006, after 54 years. He never gave up. Elmer also worked as a janitor for Pleasant Hills Methodist Church for 17 years as his second job. Elmer and Helen had four children, twin boys born November 4, 1954, Elmer Ray Johnson Jr., Ronald K. Johnson. Ronald died one day later, and Elmer Jr. died November 12th. Elmer Jr. was holding on, and his heart and lungs could not go anymore. The Lord took them home. Elmer and Helen then had two daughters, Deborah Lynn Fusco, born in 1955, and Sherry Ann Navalopoulos, born in 1957. Elmer's sister Jenny continued praying for Elmer's salvation. One day, his twin sister Elaine and her husband Cliff Prophet invited Elmer and his family to a revival meeting at Midbrook Baptist Church in Brook Park, where they were attending. The message was so clear, and the Lord spoke to Elmer. He acknowledged he was a sinner, repented, and remembered the promise he made to the Lord back in Korea. He surrendered all. Jenny's 16 years of continued prayers for him to be saved were answered. He was saved by grace. The day was Sunday, January 31st, 1965. What a changed life. Drinking was gone. Cigarettes were gone. Filthy language was gone. He became a good husband and loved his family, wanted to be an example. Life changes were huge. He had decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. He was baptized the next Sunday. His huge heart was now serving a Savior. After being born again, the Lord showed Elmer how to be very generous while giving for the Lord's work. He witnessed to his family and friends, and his brother-in-law, Walter Zidzik, and sister-in-law, Mary, got saved and attended Midbrook. He taught Sunday school, led the singing, and spoke at the Lamp Nursing Home on Ingle Road. He bought the first church bus at Midbrook and drove and maintained it. He gave to worldwide missions generously and financed the material to build the gymnasium, which he helped build with Pastor Godley, his brother-in-law, Walter, and Mr. Helderman. He was a deacon, financed many projects at Midbrook Baptist Church. He was a huge giver of Bibles and tract ministry with Baptist Mid-Missions. He supported many, many missionary families through Baptist Mid-Missions. He supported the Bill Rice Ranch, Jerry Falwell Ministries, Good News Publishers Tract Ministry, the Lighthouse Ranch, the Gaudetic Family, Missionaries to Panama, and many, many other missionary families through the years. In May 23, 1976, Elmer and Helen joined Cleveland Baptist Church. His pastors he held up in prayer were Reverend Roy Thompson, Pastor Kevin Folger, and Pastor Pete Folger. All were dear to his heart and a wonderful blessing to Elmer and his family. While attending Cleveland Baptist, he served the Lord as an usher and in the nursing home ministry. He also held services at the City Mission downtown. In the 1980s, he surrendered to go to the mission field. Though he did not get to go physically, he had compassion for missions. He supported eight missionary families for years and years. He funded what the projects they needed done. A lot was done anonymously. He wanted the gospel spread in the countries, even if he couldn't be there himself. Elmer was always caring, giving, and helping people in need. His brother-in-law and best friend, Walter, bought a tree farm property in Senecaville, Ohio. Elmer would spend 60 hours at General Motors, also have the janitor's job at Pleasant Hills Methodist Church. Completed for the week, he would head down to the farm Friday at 3 o'clock until Sunday night to help Walter build the smaller house and later the main house. When Walter went home to be with the Lord, he continued to keep the farm up and by feeding the horse and mowing acres and acres of grass every week for years until he got sick. Elmer was his daughter's landscaper and lawnmower, leaf raker and fix-it man. Whatever was needed, fixed or painted, whatever the need, he took care of it. He did it out of love for his girls. He was the example of never give up. Elmer was a wonderful grandfather of eight and a loving great-grandfather. May 7, 2007, Elmer was up all night not feeling well. He drove himself to Southwest Hospital. Later was life-flighted to University Hospital. He was operated on for a brain aneurysm. During the eight-hour operation, he suffered a stroke and was paralyzed on his right side. Many complications arose over the next 6 months, but he remained strong and never gave up. Always a soldier, for 17 years he fought to keep going. Because of Jenny's fervently praying for his salvation, generations have been saved, living for the Lord. He has impacted hundreds of people with tracts and witnessing the plan of salvation. Elmer enjoyed watching the Cleveland Indians, feeding the birds, riding his bike, cutting grass, landscaping, helping others in country gospel and bluegrass music. He loved his country. He taught his children and grandchildren about loving his country, the USA. May you wear the lapel flag pin you received today in memory of Elmer. He wanted to spread the love for his great United States of America. Philippians 4:13 was Elmer's favorite Bible verse. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I do my best for services like this to try to point us to a passage of Scripture that really is exemplified by the life that was lived. And the passage of Scripture today that I believe the Lord has led me to is a little bit of an unusual one. And you may hear me read it and you may think, why would you read that at a funeral service? But I think a connection can be made. I don't suppose too many of you brought a Bible with you today, but if you did, I'm in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 12. In this passage of Scripture, the Lord Jesus Christ gives some interesting teaching that I really think is exemplified by the life of Elmer Johnson. In verse 13, the Bible says, "And they send unto him certain of the Pharisees and of the Herodians to catch him in his words. And when they were come, they say unto him, Master, we know that thou art true and carest for no man, for thou regardest not the person of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Shall we give or shall we not give? But he, knowing their hypocrisy, said unto them, Why tempt ye me? Bring me a penny that I may see it. And they brought it. And he saith unto them, Whose is this image and superscription? And they said unto him, Caesar's. And Jesus answering said unto them, Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him." In our text, the Bible informs us that the Pharisees and the Herodians, these were two groups of people, leading groups of people in Jesus' day, and both of them were enemies of Christ. They did not have much love or compassion for Christ and his ministry. They came to him, and the Bible says they had one intention. And that intention is given to us in verse number 13. They were trying to catch him in his words. Now, they were trying to get him to say something that would be a slip-up, something that they could use against him. They came to him with a level of insincerity. We know that because the Bible says that they came to catch him in his words, but the very next verse says that they used flattery in their introduction to him. They spoke of him as being true and one that taught the way of God in truth, when in reality they didn't believe that about him at all. Knowing these individuals and understanding why they had come to him this day, it seems clear to us that all that they were saying was a lie. And the question they brought before him was this: is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Shall we give or shall we not give? That was the question that they brought to the Lord that day. So the question really is essentially, if we were to put it in our vernacular, we'd say it like this: do we have an obligation to support, to obey, and to serve Caesar, to serve our government? The Jews were humbled. They were humbled mightily to be in a position of servitude to Rome. They knew that, and the Old Testament was clear that their obedience and faithfulness to the Lord and his word would result in God's blessing. So that they were in bondage at this moment in their life, and this moment of their history, that they were in bondage to Rome, and under the authority of Caesar was a pretty strong indicator that they had slipped up along the way. And that it was a pretty strong indicator that God had brought judgment upon them. And as a result, they hated paying taxes to Caesar. They hated having to serve Rome. But as you read the text, you might be left to wonder if maybe they hated something more. Seems pretty clear that they hated Jesus even more. If they could find Jesus encouraging people to rebel against Caesar, they would happily report him to Rome and to the Roman authorities for punishment. In other words, they hated the Roman occupation, but they were willing to use Rome's power and authority if it meant the destruction of their greater enemy, Jesus. In our text, Jesus wisely navigated this complex and deceptive question. He asked for someone, "Bring me a coin, show me a coin." And when it was brought to him, he asked, "Whose picture, whose image is on this coin? Whose name is here?" Of course, they responded that the coin bore the image and the name of Caesar. Jesus indicated that since the coin bore Caesar's name and Caesar's image, then it was the responsibility of the people to give back to Caesar what was his. Jesus further indicated that they were under the responsibility to not only give the things to Caesar that belonged to Caesar, but that they were to render the things that belonged to God to God. The Bible tells us at the end of verse number 17 that they all marveled at his answer and recognized that he had successfully avoided saying or doing the wrong thing in this particular matter. Elmer Johnson grew up with a strong sense of patriotism. You've heard that over and over again as we've read these two essays. He loved his country and was so eager to defend her. He literally forged his papers at the age of 16 in order that he might join the United States Army. Of course, when this was discovered, he was quickly sent back home, but later was re-enlisted again so that he could serve. Elmer served valiantly in the Korean War and was honored and recognized for his bravery in combat. As you look around the room here today, you see evidence of Brother Johnson's love for his country. He was proud to have served, defended, and supported his nation. He loved America and was proud to be an American. I have to tell you, we need more men like him. We need more men like him. Too many today are asking how our nation and government can serve them. Elmer was a patriot. He was a member of a generation that sought to look for ways to serve their nation and government as opposed to looking for ways that their government could serve them. But I'm here to remind you, Elmer wasn't just a great American. With his life, he really completed the teaching that Christ gave in this text. Now think about that for just a moment. Did he render to Caesar the things that were Caesar's? Of course he did. He wore the United States military uniform. He paid his taxes. He served bravely and valiantly. And so without a doubt, Elmer did what Jesus instructed people to do here in Mark 12. That is to render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. But I'm happy to share with you that he was faithful not only to render to Caesar the thing that they belonged to Caesar, but to render to God the things that belonged to God. And Christ taught that it was right to do these things. And Brother Johnson lived. He lived Christ's teaching. There's no higher level of living than to figure out what it is that Jesus said and do it. Jesus said, "Whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him unto a wise man who built his house upon a rock." So I want to just share with you three things that Elmer gave to God. And I think will be an encouragement and help to you. Number one, I want to share with you that Elmer gave his heart to God. Elmer gave his heart to God. You've heard about how Elmer's sister Jenny prayed for many years for her brother's salvation. God would use another sister and her husband, Elaine and Cliff, to invite Elmer and his family to a revival meeting at the Midbrook Baptist Church. And it was at that meeting that Elmer fell under conviction and believed in his heart that God had sent his son Jesus to this earth to die on a cross for his sins. And that same Jesus rose from the dead and is alive and has power to save. The Bible says in Romans 10 verses 9 and 10 that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, Elmer was born like all of us are born. He was born with a heart that was sinful and a heart that was separated from God, a heart that was unclean. So that doesn't sound like a very kind thing to say. Well, I didn't say that. God said that. In Jeremiah chapter number 17 and verse number 9, the Bible says, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings." Hebrews 3 and verse number 12, the scripture writer warns, "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God." The heart in the Bible is not the part of man, the scientific part of man, that fleshly organ that pumps blood throughout his body. And that's not what the Bible is talking about when it talks about an evil heart of unbelief or a heart that is deceitful and desperately wicked. No, it's not a fleshly organ, but rather it is the seat of man's conscience. It's the center of not only all of man's spiritual activity, but also all the operations of human life. That, of course, is given to us according to Easton's Bible Dictionary. Through the use of your heart, you You make all the major decisions in life, including the most important decision of all, which is the decision to be born again or to be saved. So that's why preachers and Bible teachers often refer to salvation as the act of giving your heart to God. We take our heart, it's unclean, it's dirty, we give it to the Lord, He cleans it up. In fact, the Bible tells us He gives us a new heart, a clean heart. Psalm 51:10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Ezekiel 36:26, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. To Caesar belongs perhaps our physical body. Elmer gave that to Caesar. He gave that to the United States government. I'll go to war, I'll fight. But to Caesar, your heart doesn't belong to Caesar. Your heart belongs to God. And if you'll give it to the Lord, He'll give you a clean heart. He'll give you a new heart. He'll give you a saved heart. The Bible tells us these things. Notice secondly, not only did Elmer give his heart to God, but Elmer gave his life to God. Elmer gave his life to God. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Ephesians 2:10, the Bible says, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. You've heard from what was written about him today that after his conversion or after his new birth, his family and friends observed that he was not the same person that they once knew. Elmer gave up some bad habits, things like drinking and smoking and swearing. And he became a godly and faithful husband and father. And he started following Jesus. Immediately he was baptized. He began to tell others what Jesus had done for him. He taught the scriptures to others. He gave generously to the cause of Christ. And he served faithfully his church and others. Elmer understood that he had just one life to live. And that he didn't have a single day to waste. And the best life was one given to the Lord in faithful service to Him. Elmer understood that God had given him not only a new heart, but God had given him a new life, and he lived it well. Elmer continued to render to Caesar the things that were Caesar's, but more importantly, he faithfully rendered to God the things that were God's, including his heart and including his life. And then I would say thirdly and finally this morning, Elmer gave his family to God. He gave his family to God. Elmer and his wife, Helen, were married in Oak Hill, West Virginia, before moving here to Cleveland, so that Elmer could find steady work. And together they had four children. You've heard, of course, of the first two twin boys who died in infancy. And then God gave them two daughters, Deborah and Sherry. After his conversion, Elmer was a loving and faithful father. Today, both of his daughters know the Lord. His grandchildren are believers. And just yesterday, it was my privilege to baptize his great-grandson. He's somewhere in here, I think, young Wyatt. Followed the Lord in believers' baptism. I think to myself how proud his great-granddaddy would have been that he followed the Lord in believers' baptism, was so eager to do so. Elmer understood that his family was a gift from God, that his children were not his, but his children were the Lord's. They bore his image. They bore his name, and he was faithful to give them back to the Lord. Listen, there are no regrets in life when you give the Lord what belongs to Him. If you're here today, under the sound of my voice, and you've never given your heart to God, let's start there. That's the starting point. That's where we meet God. That's the beginning of our journey, is when we give Him our dirty heart, the heart that the Bible says is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. We give it to the Lord. We give Him our heart of flesh, and He takes it and He renews it and He gives us a clean heart. Would you do that? Would you do that to the Lord today? Would you give Him your heart today? Call upon Him and be saved. And if you're here today and you are saved, but perhaps maybe you're holding back from the Lord what rightfully belongs to Him. Maybe you've been born again, but you've kept your life for yourself. You've kept your family for yourself. Lord, you can't have these things are mine. I want to use them as I see fit. Can I encourage you to do what Elmer did? To give these things to the Lord. They belong to Him. We are to render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, but we're to give to God the things that are God's. Beginning with our heart, give Him our life, give Him your family. Perhaps you could think of other things. You give Him your time and your effort and your energy, your talents. But do what Elmer did, and that is render to God the things that are God's. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed for just a moment here this morning. You've listened well, and I appreciate that. We never want to take for granted that perhaps there's someone in this room that doesn't have the same hope that Elmer had. If your life were to end today, God forbid, but your family would not have the hope that they might see you again someday. You don't have a clear testimony of the new birth. The Bible is so very clear that it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy, He saved us. Salvation is not anything that you can earn. It's not anything that you can do. Salvation is only found through faith. The Bible says that without faith, it is impossible to please Him. So perhaps you're here today and you're a good person. And you're like Elmer, perhaps you maybe even served your country and you pay your taxes. Maybe even go to church every week. But you'd have to admit, I've never been given a new heart. I've never given my heart to God and allowed Him to fashion a new heart within me, clean mine up, and give me a new one. Can we begin here today? Can we look to the Lord? Can we believe on His name and trust in Him? The way of salvation is not complicated. It's very easy. In fact, Jesus did all of the work. The Bible is clear that if you'll simply call upon Him, then you can be saved. And I would urge you, I would invite you to do that right this very morning. Would you do that in the quietness of your seat? It's as simple as just crying out to Him, "Dear Jesus, I recognize and acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I understand that my sin will send me to a place the Bible calls hell. I don't want to go there. And I've heard today from Your word that You can give me a clean heart. You can give me a new heart through faith in Your Son. And so I'm calling upon You. I'm asking You to forgive me of all of my sins. Create in me a clean heart. Give me eternal life someday." If you'll pray to the Lord a prayer like that, He will save you. He's obligated to do that because He promised to do it in His word. "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And so can I urge those of you here today that perhaps don't have hope of eternal life, can I encourage you to look to Jesus, to repent of your sins, and to believe on His name? Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed for just a moment. No one is looking around, and I wouldn't want to call anyone out or embarrass them. But I wonder, is there someone here today, say, "Pastor Pete, when I came into this service, I really didn't have hope of eternal life. But I heard the gospel, and I believed the message of the gospel. And today I prayed along with you, and I cried out to Jesus to save me, and I believe that He did that. I looked to Him in simple faith. I trusted in the Lord just a moment ago. I've placed all of my faith and trust in Him, and I believe today is the day in which I received God's free gift of eternal life." Is there anyone like that at all in the room that say, I did that today, I'm not ashamed," and you'd lift your hand up long enough for me to see it? "I repented just a moment ago of my sin and believed on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just today I accepted Jesus as my Savior." Anyone like that at all? We'll wait for just a moment. Would you slip your hand up long enough for me to see it? I just want to pray for you. Can I encourage those of you that are here today that know Christ, you've given your heart to Christ, can I encourage you to give Him your life as well? Perhaps you're saved, but you know in your heart, you're not really living for the Lord. You haven't really given Christ your life. You've held some things back from Him. You're doing some things that you know He wouldn't be pleased with. Won't you give Him your life today? Perhaps maybe some of you that maybe you're holding some other things back from God, your time, your talents, your family, whatever the matter is. Hey, let's do what Elmer did. Let's render to God the things that are God. And may God help us to do so. Father, as we conclude this service, Lord, we thank You for Your word and how it speaks to our hearts. Lord, You not only are so faithful to give us Your word, but you're faithful to give us men and women in our lives who become tremendous examples of how to live. I believe with all of my heart that Elmer Johnson was one of those men. Lord, we thank You for the life that he lived. Lord, we thank You for the example that he set. Lord, as we conclude this service, we ask, Lord, that Your words of comfort would continue to ring out in our minds. Lord, we thank You for the hope that we have to see Elmer again someday. Lord, if there's someone here today, there may be someone here today does not have that hope that they're going to see Elmer again someday. May they take heed to the message and the word that was preached. Lord, we pray that you'd again comfort our hurting hearts today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.